This program is brought to you by the Foundation for Ancient Research and Mormon Studies. This lecture is one in a series exploring the message of the Book of Mormon and its invitation to everyone to come unto Christ. The speaker is John L. Sorensen. The title of this lecture is Book of Mormon in Ancient America.
As a longtime student of the Book of Mormon, I've been asked many questions about evidences. My concern today is to try to get some clear understanding of how evidences can be helpful and how they might be harmful if we misuse them. So let's think together, if we can, about the two-edged nature of evidences as we examine the Book of Mormon. Usually, when we talk about evidences, at least many people consider that a debate is going on, and indeed there is a debate going on as to whether the Book of Mormon is or is not a true and ancient record. That debate is a major debate, but of course it is not to be solved by a question of evidences in a technical or legal sense. It is a matter to be solved by the Spirit. Beyond that, however, there are those who still antagonize members of the church and believers in the Book of Mormon by insisting that they have evidence contrary to the Book of Mormon. This is countered frequently by Latter-day Saints who themselves think that that evidence, the negative evidence that is brought forward, can be countered by more positive evidence. And so we do get into a kind of a courtroom situation. I have an example here of a bit of evidence that is enough to make Latter-day Saints' mouth water. This is from a book by Laurette Séjourné on Quetzalcoatl, the ancient god figure of central Mexico. And on this sheet, I have pulled out some statements from the book Burning Water, which, when chosen, lined up as I have done them, definitely shows, at least to those who want to have it shown, that this Quetzalcoatl is Jesus Christ. What I have not shown on this sheet is that there are other statements in the book about the Quetzalcoatl, and if I lined those up, they would say some things that you certainly did not want associated with Jesus Christ. So it's a two-edged sword, the matter of evidences. You can pick and choose. That's the major concern in a debate situation or a courtroom situation, is what kind of evidence, how much evidence, how convincing is it. My primary concern, however, is not a matter of proving the Book of Mormon authentic. It is, because of its being, and because those of us who have a spiritual testimony know it is. We don't need to debate it. But there is another aspect to evidence, another kind of debate, if you will. It's how did the Book of Mormon take place, not did it take place. As a believer with a testimony, I know that it took place, but I am curious and I want understanding as to what went on. What were Nephites like when Alma was speaking to his son? How did they interchange? What language did they use? What were their gestures? What was the tone that surrounded their interview? And so on. This may seem unimportant to some people. It's not unimportant to me, because, as I'm going to say, going to show in a moment, there are good reasons why we need to be meticulous, as careful as we can. As a believer in the Book of Mormon, someone with a testimony, as I am, I do not need to win the debate with disbelievers. It becomes rather irrelevant to me, although there are those who wish to carry on the debate, and they may if they wish, as far as I'm concerned. I am more concerned with reaching out to accomplish the blessing, to bring about what Mormon described in chapter 8, verse 16 of his book. He said, "Blessed be he that shall bring this thing to light, for it shall be brought out of darkness unto light. It shall shine forth out of darkness and come unto the knowledge of the people." He's speaking, of course, of the Book of Mormon itself. And the obvious fulfillment of that blessing was on Joseph Smith. But perhaps those of us who would like to clarify, make more convincing, make more understandable the Book of Mormon, are in our own ways also bringing it to a knowledge of the people. It certainly still remains dark for some. Now let's look at the intent of the Book of Mormon as indicated on the title page, because it talks, in my view, to the whole question of evidences. In the second paragraph of the title page, Mormon, the writer, gives two objectives that he has for producing the book. One is to show unto the remnant of the house of Israel, we think of those as the Lamanites, what great things the Lord hath done for their fathers, that they may know the covenants of the Lord, that they are not cast off forever. That's the first objective or purpose Mormon has. The second is, and also to the convincing of the Jew and Gentile that Jesus is the Christ, the eternal God. It seems to me that those objectives cannot be realized without history, without context, without understanding the setting, and as many details as we can produce that give us an understanding of what went on in the lives of Nephites, Lamanites, Mulekites, and Jaredites. If we stop to think how Mormon was thinking when he wrote his second statement about Jesus the Christ, the eternal God, if he was following the Hebrew language tradition, and we have every reason to think that he was, then he would have been saying, "I want everyone to believe in Yehoshua, the Messiah, who is the eternal God." Now, Jesus Christ, of course, is a Greek-derived name that stands for, is a translation of, Yehoshua, which was the original name that everyday people would have called Jesus Christ. Now, how can we possibly appreciate and understand that Jesus Christ outside his setting? That is the Messiah. Messiah is meaningless without a knowledge of the Jews, what the Jews' expectations were, what the prophets said about the Messiah. It is not enough simply to think of Jesus Christ as the Redeemer and Savior of mankind. It must be Jesus Christ as Yehoshua, the Messiah of Israel. And the promises and covenants, the things that had happened in the past, where the Father had protected, blessed, and caused to flourish those Israelites, including the Nephites, those things cannot be understood without a sense of history either. Now, there are those who say, "I believe doctrine is all that is important in the Book of Mormon. We do not need to worry about the history." We are faced, however, with the fact that most of the Book of Mormon is history. It is not doctrine. That is, it's not doctrine in the sense of quotable proof texts, things that we can memorize and quote. Instead, history is a kind of container for the doctrine. We do not understand the form of the doctrine, the substance of the doctrine, without knowing the substance of the history. And we cannot know all the meaning of all those wars and migrations, the destructions, the ups and downs, and the social fate of the peoples in the Book of Mormon, unless we interpret it doctrinally. Doctrine and history are two sides of the same coin. We cannot have one without the other. Well, doctrine can be learned by careful reading, investigation, and study and prayer in regard to the text of the Book of Mormon as we have it. The matter of the history, however, deserves equal care and exhaustive examination. It itself, the history, is a convincer of the authenticity of the book as much as the doctrine is. I'd like to comment about a reality factor. We live in an age of fantasy where for many, especially for young people, the boundary between fantasy and reality is rather obscure. For me, the Book of Mormon events and Book of Mormon people and characters are absolutely real. I like to feel that. I'd like others to feel that the same. Think of the merits, the benefits of taking a trip to Israel. There are many who've done so, and they come back almost uniformly thrilled and enlightened by walking where Jesus walked, by visiting the Garden Tomb, the Mount of Olives. Would it not be equally valuable, equally valid, to go to Bountiful, the city where the resurrected Savior came down from heaven and stood before the Nephites and taught them those marvelous lessons that we read in 3 Nephi? It ought to be at least as valuable to see the American scenes of the Savior's teachings and the actions of the Nephites, good and bad, as to see the lands of the Jews. Well, so far, Latter-day Saints are not able to do that in any very useful way. Yes, there are Book of Mormon tours that take you broadly to lands where the Nephites were involved, but once you get there, it is a very lucky thing if you can make any direct connection between the Book of Mormon text, events, and characters, and what you see. Our pageants and our films, too often in the past, have been cardboard cutout kind of things, almost scriptural Barbies and Kens. I want them to be flesh and blood human beings, the real Nephi, the real Alma, the real Mormon and Moroni, as far as we can construct the real, discover the real. This reality, to counter the fantasy, the sense of fantasy that so many of us have about the Book of Mormon as a mere story, requires that we know where events took place and, of course, when they took place. That means geography and history with a capital H. There is a question, of course, about geography. There's been a long-standing argument in the church, actually a series of arguments, about where Book of Mormon events took place. A very common view is that the entire Western Hemisphere was involved and that Nephites and Lamanites were everywhere until the final destruction of the Nephites in New York, and then only Lamanites were left, and those are the Indians. Now, it does little for our satisfaction in understanding the scripture to take that simple-minded view. It simply is not true. The reason I say that it is not true is because when we examine the Book of Mormon, which after all is the authority on the Nephites, when we examine the Book of Mormon text and try to learn everything about it, where and when, then we find that the Nephites lived in a very small land, not quite as small as Palestine, but small nevertheless, a few hundred miles in length and 100 or 200 miles across, not thousands of miles, not the whole Western Hemisphere. If that were so, if the whole hemisphere were the scene, then the Book of Mormon text, its own statements about itself and its scene, would be wrong. Over the years, I've worked as hard as I can to try to discover, to reconstruct the mental map that Mormon had in a volume that I worked on some years ago. There is over 100 pages here, which culminates in a map which purports to be that mental map of Mormon. It does not say this is in Mexico or this is in Guatemala. It says from Zarahemla to Nephi was about so and so many miles, and you went over some mountains to get there. This representation is the fullest and most complete examination of what the Book of Mormon says about its geography. It's another matter entirely about where that was in the Western Hemisphere. It was somewhere. Now, if we're going to look at evidences, we must know the somewhere. It will do no good to find evidences in Alaska for the Nephites if the Nephites were not in Alaska, any more than to find evidences in Tibet. We need to be in the right place and in the right time period if we're going to use, for example, archaeological evidences or linguistic evidence. So if we're to construct a realistic picture, then we must settle upon a time and a place. We're in the process of doing that. A lot of Latter-day Saint scholars have worked hard at that task, and progress has been made. Some of it has been painful. This book, which I've already indicated with the Mormon's mental map in, called The Geography of Book of Mormon Events, a source book, includes all of the reconstructions of geography that I've been able to discover. There are over 60 of those in the past. They're wildly discrepant from each other. Most of them are simply out of place when compared with the actual Book of Mormon text. We're getting there toward an agreement that the events took place in southern Mexico and northern Central America, even though there may be some details on which there is not yet agreement. If we look to that area, which we call Mesoamerica, then we can find some interesting evidences, that is to say, external information found from secular scholarship, which can shed some light on the Book of Mormon, on the Nephites, by supplementing or clarifying what the Book of Mormon text itself says about them. The same kind of thing is done, of course, in relation to the Bible, where the results of archaeology, history, a number of kinds of secular studies have certainly illuminated, provided the background so that we can understand the Old Testament peoples and prophets much more clearly, and also the time of the Savior, the Christian era. The same thing we can and should do, I believe, for the Book of Mormon. It will require significant effort and, of course, a whole new set of information that we must seek out. There's a caution here, however. When we use a word like archaeology or archaeologist, most people automatically think, oh, these are authorities. They know what they are talking about. Not necessarily the case at all. They fail in many ways to be any more critical than you and I. They are trapped in a way with their opinions. They have their interpretations, which they learn from each other. There are many things which they refuse to acknowledge. As a matter of fact, in the realm of Bible studies, most of the archaeologists simply do not believe in the Bible as an inspired text. They see it as one historical document of considerable interest, but they do not take the religious sense of the Bible. Archaeologists can be wrong, linguists can be wrong, historians can be wrong. All of those who study the ancient world can be wrong in detail. Nevertheless, they control a large body of information that potentially can shed light. I want to give an example of this persistent pig-headedness, if you will, to avoid some truths, even in the pursuit of other truths. A few years ago, a colleague and I published this volume and its companion, entitled Pre-Columbian Contact with the Americas Across the Oceans. This is a bibliography that points out to persistent opponents of the idea of ancient voyaging that there was a great deal of information that indeed supports the idea, whereas the conventional scholarly view is there is no significant information. Well, there is this continuing resistance to what seems perfectly good evidence in a debate as to whether there were voyagers across the ocean. So some specialists, some scholars, some archaeologists, linguists, and others simply are hard-headed. But I'm not trying to convince them. I'm trying to use what they produce for our enlightenment about the Book of Mormon. In order to do so, then, we must internally examine the Book of Mormon as exhaustively and as carefully, as critically as we can, trying not to miss a single beat in it, trying to pay complete attention with our whole heart, might, mind, and strength to everything it has to tell us about itself. With that, both the internal and exhaustive external information, it is then possible to avoid the cardboard cutout scene. It is possible, will be possible someday, to take a real Book of Mormon tour to real Book of Mormon sites. At least I trust so, I think so, I'm confident so. Now, meanwhile, until we have perfection, until we have all of this information settled, confirmed, clarified, backed up, we have some partial information, we have some valuable information, we can, in fact, know something useful and new, helpful, about the setting of the Book of Mormon. In the past, 1984, in the Ensign, I published two articles called Digging into the Book of Mormon, Our Changing Understanding of Ancient America and Its Scripture, which recounted some of those evidences with the intent not of debating, but of clarifying and conferring enlightenment on those who wish to know more. Very soon after that, I published a book called An Ancient American Setting for the Book of Mormon that laid out much more of that material. Far more should be and could be presented at the present time. So there are materials that can already enlighten us about the setting, the scene, or scenes, the characters, the people in general, their clothing, their faces, their architecture, and the like. Incidentally, at the present time, filming is continuing on a set of ancient set pieces, film pieces intended to teach church education students about the Book of Mormon. Though those scenes that are being represented as the scenes for Nephite life are by far the best documented of any that have been attempted so far. They are not perfect. We do not know enough to clothe all the characters in those film scenes perfectly, just like the Nephites. We know enough, however, to make them seem realistic, to come somewhat closer than we could in the past, with more information, with more, quotes, evidences, we will be able to make a more realistic, understandable, and enlightening picture of the Nephites and the other ites. Now I'd like to speak about a few of the specifics of evidences, the kinds of things that one would like to know about either to conduct the debate with the disbelievers, or that one would like to know about in order to understand and appreciate Book of Mormon peoples and characters better, in a more enlightening way, to bring it out of darkness, in other words. We'll start with archaeology because that's where most evidences seem to start. We have to realize that the archaeologists are left to dig the garbage of the world. They find very little of what was left from ancient life. All the good stuff is gone long since. So they're doing makeup. They're doing make do. They're doing what they can to construct a picture of ancient life from the leftovers. So we do not know a great deal about, for example, beliefs or customs. We can't see the behavior of the people from the artifacts. What we can see is the results in the form of artifacts, buildings, archaeological sites, and so on. We get as much information as we can from these archaeological materials, but we must understand that there is a great deal that we will never learn. We will never learn. You cannot learn about the life of Jesus Christ by visiting New Testament sites. What you can learn is about the setting, the stage on which the life was acted out.
This is the end of side one. You may turn the tape over now to continue the program.
The archaeologists sometimes disappoint us because they do not come up with what we wish they would come up with. We would like the Sword of Laban or a copy of the Sword of Laban. As a matter of fact, we don't know what the Sword of Laban looked like. We don't know what a copy would look like. If we find any sword at all, we are fortunate, and it does provide us some light and intelligence about Nephite arms, Nephite armies, and Nephite combat then. We can find, for example, in Mesoamerica, some very interesting fortifications, and I've written on that subject. All kinds of fortifications mentioned or discussed in any degree in the Book of Mormon are to be found in parallel somewhere in Mesoamerica, and most of those, at least many of them, go back into the proper period and by my standards are in the proper places to potentially be Nephite or Lamanite in nature and form. If we then want to construct a believable, understandable, artistic representation of a Nephite battle, a Nephite-Lamanite battle, we're in fairly good shape to do it. However, the representation may not be what our, that is to say, our modern anticipations or guesses might be. We may be wrong. For example, further, what kind of animals did the Nephites have? The terms cattle, horses, sheep, and so on are mentioned at several points in the Book of Mormon in the Nephite record. And it is dismaying to some who wish to be dismayed, I believe, and a few others who wish an answer could be provided, why there are not cows like we mean cows, horses like we mean horses, sheep like we mean sheep. The fact is, however, that all the ancient studies say those animals simply were not present in the New World. Period. They were not here. Well, 99.9%, period. There is some little possibility of some horses, as we know horses. The likelihood, however, is that we must go back to the text again. We see the internal having to articulate constantly with the external. We get some ideas from the internal, look outside, try to get enlightening, illuminating information. And then we may have to go back into the text and reread it and understand, let's see now, when Mormon said this, what did he really mean? Did he mean what I think he means, or shall we read it the way he wrote it and meant it in his mind? We do not know that when he said horse, he meant our kind of horse. So we look at examples in the New World when the Spaniards brought horses, and we find, for example, that the Aztecs in central Mexico referred to the deer that men rode on. Is it possible that the horses in the Book of Mormon were deer? It is possible. We certainly do not know that. There are a few artistic representations, a figurine here, a painted vase seen here, a sculptured monument there, that seem to show riders on probable deer. Whether this was common, uncommon, we don't know. It is possible that Nephite horses were deer. We do not know that. But it is an interesting possibility. This is the kind of thing that we need to be prepared for so that we do not insist that my present partially informed or even uninformed guess as to what the evidence will look like is what will turn up. We need to find such evidence as there is. We only need to deal with the truth. We need to understand the Book of Mormon text for what it tells us as truth. We need to understand archaeology, art history, as far as we can, for the truth that is in it and not for the mere opinions of the scholars who are so engaged. The same, of course, is true of legends, traditions, the documents. And remember that I began by talking about Quetzalcoatl. We do not, in fact, find a complete, clear-cut set of traditions that say somebody came down from heaven and preached a sermon at a place called Bountiful 1,500 to 2,000 years ago. We do not find that anywhere. What we find are some statements that are sort of like that. They're interesting enough. For example, Quetzalcoatl is reported in some of the central Mexican materials to have gone to the underworld for 4 days, not 3 days, where he preached, taught, communicated, at least, with the dead. Now, is that evidence or is it not evidence? Well, it is sort of evidence. It is evidence of one kind, but maybe not as neat, maybe not as nice as we would like. When we carry on this mutual interaction, however, between the internal analysis, our most careful reading of the scriptural text, and the external information, if we do it, massage it back and forth, then we find a great deal of interest in the text that we never knew was there. Take, for example, the matter of corn or maize, the key New World agricultural crop. It is an American plant. There may have been some maize in the Old World, but generally speaking, the scholars say there were no maize plants anywhere in the Old World until Columbus and his immediate followers carried corn back to the Old World after 1492. Well, a Book of Mormon text might be expected then to mention maize or corn, and in fact does so. In the 7th and the 9th chapters of the Book of Mosiah, we are told that among the Zenophites, there was corn being grown. As a matter of fact, in the second of those statements, what is said is that that was the favorite crop or food seed plant of the Lamanites. That's what they stole primarily from the Zenophites, was the corn. It would appear that that maize or corn was already a major component of the diet of Lamanites and of Zenophites, who were Nephites of a sort, isolated Nephites. Now, where did that maize come from? Because Nephi, nor the Mulekites, nor the Jaredites could have brought it. None of them could have brought it because it was not in the Old World in their day. Therefore, it is an American plant. How did they get it? How did they know it was a crop? How did they know how to cook it? How did they know the probably 50 different recipes for preparing corn and maize as a food? How did they acquire the taste for it? Well, when we ask questions like that, then we have to go back to the text and ask ourselves a whole different set of questions that in our naivety we may never have asked before. When we ask such a question as, where did the Nephites get, or the Lamanites, get maize and corn, then we understand that the Jaredites really could not have all been killed at the final battle of the Jaredites. It is completely absurd to suppose that every one of the Jaredites showed up to be slaughtered. Surely there were many who headed off for the hills in this place or that, and they knew how to plant corn. And if they survived, then we may safely presume that Nephites and Lamanites learned from those survivors, whatever they were called, whatever they were known by to the Nephites and Lamanites, that it was those people who taught Nephites and Lamanites how to plant corn, when the rain was to come, when the seed was ready, what you do with the thing, the cobs when they are to be stored, and so on and so on and so on. A whole cultural complex passed from Jaredite survivors, we may presume, to Nephites and Lamanites. Now to me, that is enlightening. It presents a picture that I did not have when I was a youth reading the Book of Mormon. It tells me that there probably were many features of life passed on from the Jaredites who were not all eliminated automatically in that final battle. Thus, we see that there were Jaredite names utilized to name individuals like Coriantumr and many others. Even the name Moroni means, in Hebrew, from Moron, from the land of Moron. And Moron was the Jaredite capital. Where in the world did Moroni get that name? Well, we don't know, but it seems to have a Jaredite connection. All of this, then, is part of shedding light, establishing the setting, giving a broadened understanding of how the Book of Mormon events took place, how the people lived, what they were doing, the history behind the history, as Paul Harvey says, the rest of the story. Well, it's not just corn. There is also wheat. There is no reason to think that Nephi and his folks brought wheat. After all, if they had brought wheat seeds from Jerusalem, would they have survived 8 years in the desert in terribly dry, hot Arabia, plus then 2 years perhaps building the ship in a fairly damp, bountiful land, a trip across the ocean, more than halfway around the world? How many seeds could have been not soaked several times in that trip, and then planted in a new land? Would that wheat have grown? Maybe, maybe not. In any case, when we go back to the Book of Mormon text, we do not find that they mention that they planted wheat seeds, just seeds, whatever they may have been. And while they also announced that those seeds flourished initially, we have many historical situations that indicate that just because seeds flourish initially does not mean they become thoroughly established and useful thereafter. Perhaps then the wheat among the Nephites was some other plant, a local plant that was enough like wheat to deserve the name, but was not old-fashioned, that is, old-world wheat. So the plants, the animals, the swords, need the swords of the Nephites have been the same looking swords, the same style of swords, the same materials as the swords in Palestine? Maybe only in function, maybe only in general. That remains to be seen. The words in the Book of Mormon itself are too few, too scarce, too obscure to settle many of these questions about setting. We do find swords in Mesoamerica, swords of several kinds, but they seem like kind of strange swords compared with those that Nephi and Lehi knew when they left Palestine. They may still have been the same swords the Nephites and Lamanites talked about, however. So we have these various sources. We have what the archaeologists dig up. We have what the legends or traditions report, but those are in words. And those words, their true sense may escape us. At least we have to interpret them all, just as we have to interpret the artifacts, interpret the scenes. Another major source for shedding light, for establishing this reality context, is the living descendants of Nephites and Lamanites. Because after all, if in the Near East it is possible still to find tent-dwelling Arabs, and Professor Nibley has taught us a good deal about this, if we can find tent-dwelling Arabs, many of whose customs, ways, and ways of thinking reflect Lehi's day, is it not at least as understandable that the descendants of Laman and Lemuel, Nephi, Jacob, the Almas, and so on, that their descendants still living in the lands today would be carrying on customs, activities, saying things, thinking and feeling things, which would be equally applicable, which would be equally enlightening about some of the things that were happening in their ancestors' day? I think it is. And so we can, and scholars have, studied many of these people and have learned some very interesting and important things. Of course, many of them have changed substantially in their way of life, but not entirely, by the 1990s. When the Spaniards first arrived, however, in Mesoamerica, in Book of Mormon lands, in the early 1500s, those people wrote down some very interesting things which no longer prevail. They've disappeared. They're gone. We cannot find those customs, those ways of thinking anymore. For example, the tent, or tents, mentioned in the Book of Mormon as part of the equipment of armies, those tents were known and reported by the Spaniards when they arrived, but of course nothing of that kind is preserved because there are no longer any native armies. There are sorts of tents, that is temporary shelters, generally and broadly somewhat similar to those tents, but they're not called tents anymore. So we're fortunate to be able to go back to what the Spaniards discovered, saw, and reported, and thus be enlightened about some of the customs, activities, and scenery of the time and place of the actual Book of Mormon characters. Architecture, for example. What was Nephi's temple like? What was any Nephite temple like? What was the temple like at the city of Bountiful when the Savior arrived? What did it look like? Anything like our temples? Well, no. It was built, that is to say, Nephi's was built along the same lines as the Temple of Solomon in Jerusalem, which Lehi and Nephi and others of that family had seen before their departure. So Nephi consciously copies it. What was it like, however? Well, we find, as a matter of fact, evidence, if you will, enlightenment in that Mesoamerican temples had an entrance with two pillars standing in the front on either side of a doorway that bore no weight. They were just standing pillars that ended in a top. That's exactly the same as for the Temple of Solomon where there were two pillars and the names are given in the account about the construction of that temple. The form of the temple in Mesoamerica, what are thought to be temples anyway, the form is similar to descriptions of the Temple of Solomon. The emphasis at the Temple of Solomon was not on the structure, that is, the enclosed space inside. Worshippers did not go inside. A priest occasionally went inside, but the large majority operated, carried on their sacrifices, did their worship outside in the court. The Mormon equivalent would be that you'd hold meeting on Temple Square, but not inside a tabernacle or the temple. That is exactly the case also with the Mesoamerican temples. It was sacrifices made on altars that look very Jewish, look very Israelite, and those were in front of temples. Those were near temples. And many of the concepts that the Spaniards reported associated with the temples, with God, with the idea of heavens, with communication with heaven, with sacrifice, the occasions for sacrifice, incense, a whole complex of those things is similar in Mesoamerica as in the Near East. Evidence, yes, once more, if somebody wants to debate evidence, we can make a case that says in Mesoamerica we find many of the features of life in Palestine anciently among the Israelites. We can match point after point, and there's a pretty impressive list of those characteristics. But if we don't want to debate, for me, it is still very enlightening to understand what it was like to go to the temple for a Nephite, to be at the temple when the Savior came and taught them in a courtyard in front of the temple, probably within a low wall. Well, these are the kinds of things we can look for. Lists can be made. Pictures can be found in the ancient artifacts. I am at the present time, as a matter of fact, preparing a picture book, attempting to find the most authentic possible representations of ancient life in Mesoamerica that can be directly connected, or in some cases, a little less than directly connected with statements in the Book of Mormon. What flocks were, what temples looked like, how people ate, what the foods were, what was bread. For example, we have no indication that there was raised yeast, raised bread anywhere in the Americas. There were tortillas, that's all. But then that's what they had in Palestine too, for the most part. So, enlightenment or debate, argument, take your pick. The information comes from the same place. But we must be careful. Back to the two-edged sword. We can cut ourselves on this evidence. And let me give one particular case that shows where a lot of people have got bloodied hands, even though they may not feel the hurt. At Izapa, a famous archaeological site, a ritual site anciently, which is located practically on the border between Guatemala and Mexico, the state of Chiapas, near the Pacific coast, there are extensive monuments and temple structures and palace structures, or whatever one wishes to call them. We're never quite sure. At this major site, there are over 70 large stone monuments. Some of them are difficult to see now because of weathering. I believe that there is an important benefit for us Latter-day Saints in dealing with the Book of Mormon as a real, that is, a realistic document of ancient life. It requires us, in order to extract the most information about ancient life, to read that in a way that most of us are not used to reading it. It is important even for a doctrinal understanding of the Book of Mormon, that we do so. Because only when we understand the history, the scenery, the events, the contexts, the settings, the motives, and the cultural background, only when we understand those will we be as clear as we can be about why Nephi said what he did at a given moment, why Alma said what he did at a given moment, why Mormon chose to incorporate what he did choose to incorporate in his book at the end of the Nephite era. All of those things are clarified, can potentially be clarified at least, by an increased knowledge of the setting, the background of the Book of Mormon. Finally, I think it would be appropriate if we devoted ourselves to emulating Mormon, who gave his life, and Moroni, his son, who ended his life, with full devotion to passing this record to those who need it, to us and to our generations.
For more information about the Book of Mormon and other related topics, call 1-800-327-6715.